السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Alright, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone, once again. First of all, I want to wish all of you a blessed Eid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of your good deeds in Ramadan, your Quran, your prayers, your fasting, everything that you put forth in this Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be able to continue this after Ramadan as well. It's been a beautiful month. Obviously, we've had our share of tragedies this Ramadan. You know, subhanAllah, it reminds me of a couple of years ago where Gaza in 2014 was constantly being bombarded as we were going through Ramadan. It was a very difficult time for us around the world, emotionally at least. And this time, you know, it started with Orlando and then it went and continued, and we've seen nonstop attacks in Nigeria and Somalia and Turkey and Bangladesh and in Iraq, obviously in Medina, in Indonesia, and Afghanistan. It's been quite tragic in Yemen, and I can't go through all the countries. I know that people often get upset that I miss countries. It's never intentional. It's all around the world. But it's been a heartbreaking you know, month in regards to those attacks. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the fitna that exists in the world today. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on our brothers and sisters that have been killed, any innocent brothers and sisters that have been killed around the world, or anyone that passed away this Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings in this month with them or with anyone else. But Eid Mubarak to you all, first and foremost. You know, Jazakumullah khair, especially to those of you that have tuned in on a daily basis. This is now over 15 hours worth of content, subhanAllah. So you've almost spent an entire day of the month with me, you know, going through the Quran, walillah alhamd. So anyway, we're now on Juz'a Amma. And Juz'a Amma, just a few reflections on the last Juz'a, just to start with. Number one, it's truly a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Qur'an is not, you know, is not set out or is not structured chronologically like a story, right? If it was structured over 23 years like a story, then the end of the book would be Medina, and it would be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the administration and so on and so forth, everything that took place in Medina. But now what we're looking at instead, of course, there's wisdom to the tartib, to the way that the Quran is actually structured, the system of the Quran. And here the last juz, which is a juz that, you know, that is common to most Muslims, where Muslims will memorize a significant portion of this juz. It takes us back to the very beginning of the revelation, and it takes us back to a place of recognizing ethics, recognizing the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, recognizing the importance of accountability, recognizing the importance of believing in a hereafter, and so on and so forth. So it really sets the stage for us, and Juz'a Amma is enough to build out our spiritual compass. So that a lot of the administrative things that come in, you know, throughout the Quran, a lot of the very specific laws, would have already, you know, become natural habit of a believer who is governed by the moral compass of Juz'a Amma. So Juz'a Amma is a juz that is a chapter that, you know, the Muslims need, each and every single one of us needs, and it really sets the spiritual framework for everything else that comes in the Quran. And the way that the juz is structured is that you could read it and it could be read like a book all by itself, subhanAllah. So the first surah in Juz'a Amma, which is Surah An-Naba, has a portion of all of the elements that are mentioned throughout the juz. So Surah An-Naba, which is the longest surah, which is not very long, but it's the longest surah, it's 40 ayat in Juz'a Amma. It sort of lays the groundwork for everything that you're going to read in Juz'a Amma, and it gives us an exposure to each and every single subject that would be covered to some extent. So it gives us an exposure. عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ عَنِ النَّبَأِ الْعَظِيمِ, the mockery of those that were rejecting the Prophet ﷺ, the news of the hereafter. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِيهِ مُخْتَلِفُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gives us some ayat about his power and the manifestation of his power and his control. أَلَمْ يَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then talks about this idea of us being resurrected and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge us with justice. So the hereafter is discussed, justice is discussed, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will carry out justice. And then from verse 21 onwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about hellfire and paradise. So post judgment, on the day of judgment, what happens to us when we enter into hellfire or paradise, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people of paradise. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then ends off with the mention of His mercy, and at the same time, the regrets of those people who did not heed the message as it came, and instead they mocked it and they rejected it. So it started off with عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ, you know, what are they asking about, and the mockery and so on and so forth. And it ends off with يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفًّا لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَقَالَ صَوَابًا ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ الْحَقُّ فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَى رَبِّهِ مَآبًا إِنَّا أَنذَرْنَاكُمْ عَذَابًا قَرِيبًا يَوْمَ يَنْظُرُ الْمَرْءُ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَاهُ وَيَقُولُ الْكَافِرُ يَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ تُرَابًا. So the very end of the surah is the same person who was asking about this news, عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ, what is this news, what is this message, and even mocking it. At the end of it, they're saying, we wish we were dust. So it starts off with their words and it ends with their words, meaning we wish we were reduced to non-existence on the day of judgment, when they see that that this has actually come true, that which they mocked actually turned out to be the truth, then they would actually call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and wish to no longer exist. Surah An-Nazi'at, which is the next surah now, it takes us to the day of judgment. So two things actually coming apart, you know, where the earth starts to rattle and the world starts to come apart as we know it. So it starts off immediately with Qiyamah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the hearts of the people throughout Qiyamah. So in Surah An-Naba, you know, you see the very beginning of the day of resurrection at the end of the surah, where they are seeing that justice is being carried out even amongst the animals. And so they would say, Ya laytani kuntu turaba, I wish I was dust, I wish I could be rendered to dirt and to non-existence like the animals, because they see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will establish justice perfectly, and they know that they have been unjust. So this is the very beginning of the day of judgment. In Surah An-Nazi'at, قلوب يومئذ واجفة أبصارها خاشعة, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the hearts of these people racing with fear as they see the day of judgment playing out in front of them, their faces weighed down in humiliation and so on and so forth, and regret. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala particularly mentions to us the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun, and particularly Fir'aun's response to Musa alayhi salam. So in Surah Taha, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى, has the story of Moses come to you? With Musa alayhi salam, with Moses, peace be upon him, the emphasis was on the conversation between Allah and Musa alayhi salam, and the personal journey of Musa alayhi salam, because the surah was meant to give that to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to anyone who follows in that example, comfort and reassurance to the caller. In Surah An-Nazi'at, Allah emphasized the response of Fir'aun. So it immediately goes to the response of Fir'aun as a warning to those that are acting like Fir'aun. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَىٰ أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ, that verily in that is a sign for people who reflect, for people who have humility and awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just like Allah dealt with Fir'aun, He could deal with you. And just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and created the skies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could also bring you about. So are you more difficult to create, or the magnificent universe that you see amongst you? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes His proof. And once again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَأَنَّهُمْ, that at the end of the surah, كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَاهَا, that it would be at, you know, when they're standing. So once again, it ends at the same place. Like Surah An-Naba ends with the person standing, with the rejecter standing, the denier standing and saying, I wish I never saw this, I wish I never existed. Here, once again, you arrive at the person who denied it standing and looking around, and it would be as if they did not live on the earth except for a small portion of a day. So their life in this world would seem insignificant, and it would seem very short as they're seeing the eternity that comes afterwards. So when they're standing on the hereafter, once again, we get to the place of them standing, and the thoughts, the internal thoughts of that person as he's standing on the Day of Judgment, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing our internal thoughts in this world, and Allah is giving us a message to the heart in this world, so that we can adjust our lives in accordance with that which we see. So Surah Abasa then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala particularly mentions those who cheat people. I'm sorry, not those who cheat people, I'm sorry. Surah Abasa now is Abdullah bin Umm Maktum radiallahu ta'ala anhu coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa huwa yakhsha. He's running to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's a blind man, and he's asking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alimni mimma alamaka Allah, teach me from what Allah taught you. So he's, the same words are used, you know, yasa'a wa yakhsha, he's running and he's pacing and he's in awe. The same words are used to describe Abdullah bin Umm Maktum radiallahu ta'ala anhu coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to inquire about the Day of Judgment, as they are to describe Fir'aun trying to run away from the Day of Judgment. So Fir'aun, وَهُوَ يَسْعَى, he was pacing in his palace to avoid responding to the message. Abdullah ibn Maktum was running to the Prophet ﷺ in order to gain, to gain knowledge of the hereafter and to protect himself from what comes in the hereafter. And just like the other surahs that have already come, we see once again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presenting some of the evidences of his creation subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how he would how he has created the heavens and the earth. And once again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends off the surah with the faces of the people on the Day of Judgment. So it's always, you know, Juz' Amma is always a shock. Every surah in Juz' Amma is very straight to the point. It's precise and straight to the point. Concise, precise, and straight to the point, right? It's really, really there, subhanAllah. So it brings you back to, once again, the faces. So from verse 33 to 42, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the faces of glory, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the faces of humiliation once again. And then we get to Surah At-Takwir. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that whoever wants to see, that, or whoever wants to know, or to see, man arada an yanzur, whoever wants to see the Day of Judgment, as if it is playing out in front of him, then let him read Surah At-Takwir, Surah Al-Infitar, and Surah Al-Inshiqaq, three of the next four surahs, which go into the very, very, very specific details of the Day of Judgment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning, in Surah At-Takwir, the world starting to come apart. So the first 14 ayat of Surah At-Takwir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is illustrating to us, or highlighting to us, the way that the world starts to come apart on the Day of Judgment, and how everything starts to change. The mountains are being reduced to dust, the sun is darkened, the stars are falling, and on that day, each person will know that which they brought forth to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عَلِمَتْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ وَأَخَّرَتْ. So a person would know what they brought forth to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of their bad deeds, and they would know of that which they left behind. So once again, the realization comes to us when we see the Day of Judgment, when we see things taking place around us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defends the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that innahu laqawlu rasulin kareem, that these are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these are the words of a noble messenger in Jibreel alayhi salam, bringing it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wama sahibukum bimajnoon, your companion is not a madman, but rather, he is someone who is divinely inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you would think that you've gone mad when you start seeing the world around you coming apart, but now you're accusing the Prophet of being a madman for telling you about the inevitable ending of the world and going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's Surah At-Takwir. And then you go into Surah Al-Infitar, which goes into the same tone, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of describing the coming apart of the world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ. O mankind, what has deluded you from your Lord the Most Generous? So Surah At-Takwir talks about the unfolding of the Day of Judgment and the coming apart of the world, and to deliver the message that your Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, is not a madman, that he is speaking the truth, that he's prophesied this. And Surah Al-Infitar comes to the message of what has deluded you from your Lord. Think about yourself. What is it that has taken you away from the most generous, that has taken you away from your Lord who is most generous and most noble, and so on and so forth. So why is it that you are not acknowledging the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you? So Surah Al-Infitar continues on the same tone of Surah Al-Takwir, but it becomes more personal to you. You know, what's your problem? You know, stop trying to deflect and accuse the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of having a problem. What's your problem for being deluded from the favors of your Lord? Why are you turning away from your Lord? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that diagnoses the core of the problem, which is that people are turning away from the truth, or people are denying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that, you know, they were denying him and they were rejecting him despite knowing that it was the truth, because of their greed, because they thought that, you know, that like the quality of life is better if we deny the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to you, what is it that is causing you to turn away from your Lord? مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ. What's wrong with you? Why are you insisting on turning away from your Lord? الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ. Stop, you know, fine, you don't want to talk about the hereafter, but what about the one who created you and he molded you, right? And he gave you guidance and he gave you a path, right? What about that? Why aren't you thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that? And what has made you deluded in regards to your Lord? Surah Al-Mutaffifin makes a particular mention of people that cheat in business. You know, the Quran, as it was revealed very early on, did not avoid injustice, did not avoid dhulm. The Quran addressed dhulm in the very, very, you know, oppression and injustice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed it in the earliest revelations. Allah addressed in Surah At-Takwir, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When the young girl that was buried alive is asked for what crime she was killed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke up against female infanticide. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, in one of the early revelations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks up, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals and speaks about the cheating in economics, cheating with the weights. So economic injustice and cheating in business. These are the things that we would be asked about on the Day of Judgment as well. Of course, the main thing we'd be asked about is shirk and whether we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on and so forth. But we're not going to get away with injustice in every other way. Right, shirk is dhulmun azim, it's the greatest form of injustice. But there are other injustices as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now mentioning the economic injustice. People that cheat in their business, people that cheat with their money, and people that cheat with their weights. And finally, Surah Al-Inshiqaq, in this progression, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once again, in the same tune of Surah Al-Takwir and Surah Al-Infitar, mentions the coming apart of the world and the way that things are unfolding on the Day of Judgment, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment will hand us our suhuf. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِ فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. So now we're at the Day of Judgment. Whoever receives his book in his right hand will have an easy accountability. Whoever receives his book in his left hand will have a difficult accountability. Surah Al-Buruj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the story of Ashab al-Ukhdud, the people of the ditch, the people who were murdered unjustly for no other reason except that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of it basically saying, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ, that the Qur'an is preserved with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter how much you malign it, no matter how much you kill people for believing in the message, and you oppress people for believing in the message will survive. Fi lawhin mahfuz, it is honored and everlasting in the preserved tablet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of your efforts to suppress the message will be futile, and all of your efforts to oppress the people for believing in this message will also, at the end of the day, turn back against you and come back to ruin you. Surah At-Tariq once again speaks about the way that we are created, and the end of Surah At-Tariq, just like the end of Surah Al-Buruj, speaks about the veracity of the Quran, the glory of the Quran. Surah Al-A'la, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, sort of is a response to that subhanAllah, it's one of the musabbihat, it's one of those surahs that starts off with the glorification, the declaration of the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we are commanded to declare the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his creation, in his essence, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having created everything, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having perfect attributes, having an essence that is unlike any of his creation. So we're supposed to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us that وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى that which is وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى, sorry, that the hereafter is better and everlasting. That some people refuse this reminder because they think this world is better. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى, the hereafter is better and it is everlasting, it's longer lasting. So it's better and it stays longer. Meaning, it's a guarantee to the, for example, the people of Ashab al-Ukhdud, two surahs before in Surah al-Buruj, that though they were killed, that they received the fawz, that they succeeded because they received the blessing and the felicity of the hereafter. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not let them down. And for us as well, we should give precedence to the hereafter, the life of the hereafter, rather than the life of this world. And why? Because in Surah Al-Ghashiyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ الْغَاشِيَةِ, when the overwhelming event comes, وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ خَاشِعَةٌ عَامِلَةٌ نَاصِبَةٌ, you will see people that will have humiliated faces that look like people that were overworked and exhausted, but it yielded no good for them whatsoever. And you'll have another group of people, نَاعِمَةٌ وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاعِمَةٌ لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ, you would have people whose faces would be bright and they would look like they're at ease and at peace, and لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ, they would be pleased with the efforts and the work that they've done in this life. So if you didn't work in this world, then you need to work in the next world. That's basically the message here. And again, سَعَى was used to describe Fir'aun working for this world, and سَعَى was used to describe Abdullah ibn Maktum working for the hereafter. So in Surah Al-Ghashiyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the two groups, that one group of people is overworked, looks overworked and exhausted because they still have to do work in the hereafter because they did not work in this world. Another group of people have peace in their faces and they look like they're at ease because they know that which they have done was worth it. لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ, they are pleased with that which they put forth to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Fajr then mentions to us very specific examples of Ad and Thamud and Fir'aun, those who were arrogant and those who received the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Fajr also mentions to us people whose happiness is entirely conditional on their situation in this world. So they haven't learned وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى, that the hereafter is better and everlasting. They haven't learned that the thing that you should be working for is to have ease in eternity. So instead, فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمَنَ وَأَمَّا إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ فَقَدَرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَهَانَنَ. So these people that would, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them in this world, then they will happily say and they would boast that my Lord has honored me. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests them with restricting some of their sustenance in this world, and if they are tested with something in this world, then they would say, my Lord has humiliated me. So the point is that their happiness and their belief in Allah is entirely dependent upon how much Allah gives them in this world, and that sort of defeats the point. So instead, يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّ, at the end of Surah Al-Fajr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the soul at peace, the one who did not attach his spirituality to his worldly circumstances, but instead entirely sought the pleasure of his Lord. What is said to him as he comes out of his body, as his soul comes out? يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّ ارْجِعِي إِلَى رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً فَدُخُلِي فِي عِبَادِي وَدُخُلِي جَنَّتِي. O soul at peace, come back to your Lord, pleased and well-pleasing. Enter you amongst my servants, enter you my paradise. Surah Al-Balad establishes the right of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to live in Mecca, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns those that think they own this world and those that think they own this earth and those that think that they can harm and they can do what they do without consequence. SubhanAllah, I've already run out of time, right? Surah Al-Shams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the essence of the soul, and basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions how he gives us all of these signs and the sun and the moon and the stars around us and the creation around us in their perfect state. And all of this. So Surah Al-Shams is a surah of oaths. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by all of these different things in order to tell us that قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا, that the one who is able to purify his soul has succeeded. So Allah swears by everything in its most perfect state. The sun, as it rises, as you see the sun rise, when the sun is at its brightest, when the moon is full. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us everything with its maximum potential, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the importance of perfecting our souls and perfecting our own tazkiyah and realizing the full potential of the self with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the good that can come out of it. If we allow destructive laws, spiritual diseases to overcome us, then we will be like the people of Thamud, the evil people of Thamud, the arrogance that they had because they did not check their pride. So collectively as a nation, they did not check their pride. And so they received the destruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instead. So the importance of realizing our best potential, our best selves as much as we can. If we continue onward, Surah Al-Layl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the most perfect soul after the prophets, the most perfect man after the prophets. The Prophet said, the sun has not risen or set on a man after the prophets that is as great as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Why? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the demonstration in Surah Al-Shams of a person who realizes the perfection of or a person who realizes tazkiyah, who realizes the full potential of their soul, their human capacity. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Layl the one who gives and the one who spends, and he's not looking for any type of praise, he's not soliciting any type of praise in this world. إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. He is seeking the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will please him. And that's exactly what we see happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleases the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleases Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu because he is that nafsud mutma'inna, he is that self that is at peace that Allah was talking about in Surah Al-Fajr, and he is that one that realizes tazkiyah as in Surah Al-Shams. Surah Al-Duha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you were not abandoned, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was with you all along, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be with the people, to show ihsan to the people, excellence to the people, as Allah showed excellence to them. Surah Al-Sharh, the next surah, Al-Inshirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the favor of expanding the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and removing his burden. And it's a follow-up to Surah Al-Duha, and that's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu considered Surah Al-Duha and Surah Al-Sharh one surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed the burden from the hearts of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Allah fixed his external circumstances, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed the burden internally from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just to keep on going, inshallah ta'ala, Surah Al-Alaq, the first few verses of the Quran revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to read, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, read in the name of your Lord who creates. So خلق الإنسان من علق, he created man from a suspended clot. اقرأ وربك الأكرم, read and your Lord is most generous. Remember in the beginning of this juz, ما غرك بربك الكريم, what has taken you away from your noble Lord, what has deluded you in regards to your noble Lord, the one who created you. الذي خلقك فسواك فعدلك. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls man to recognize the generosity of his Lord. And here you have a situation in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and calls mankind to read the scripture and to heed divine revelation that comes to us from our noble creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Qadr, inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have granted us laylatul qadr. Allahumma ameen, the reward of laylatul qadr. We've just finished the last 10 nights. So Surah Al-Alaq talks about the revelation. Read the revelation. The next surah, Surah Al-Qadr, is Inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr. We revealed it on laylatul qadr. So Surah Al-Alaq came down on laylatul qadr. Surah Al-Qadr is about laylatul qadr. And so it connects the two. Finally, there are many verses about, many surahs that talk about death and that talk about the hereafter. Surah Al-Adiyat, Surah Al-Zalzala, Surah Al-Qari'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about our addiction to this world, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the reality and the inevitability of death and the hereafter in a group of surahs that comes. So you have Surah Al-Adiyat, you have Surah Al-Zilzal, you have Al-Qari'ah, you have Al-Takathur. And at the end of it, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Wal-Asr, innal insana lafi khusr illa ladhina amanu wa aminu salihati wa tawasaw bilhaqi wa tawasaw bisabr. So after talking about man's addiction to this world and man's ignoring the inevitability of that which comes after, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by time, al-asr, time as it fleets away. Inna al-insana lafi khusr, verily man is in loss, except for those who believe, illa ladhina amanu wa aminu salihat, and work deeds of righteousness, wa tawasaw bilhaqi wa tawasaw bisabr, and they cooperate with one another and enjoin one another in works of truth and in patience in adhering to that truth. Just at the very end of this juz, obviously what we have, and I'll just go to this, Surah Al-Nasr. I'm sorry, first Surah Al-Kafirun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Kafirun tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not compromise on the message that's been given to you. Do not compromise on the message that's been given to you. Right? Because they were coming to the Prophet ﷺ in his most vulnerable moments and telling the Prophet ﷺ, you worship our gods for one day of the year even. We will worship your God for the entire year. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the Prophet ﷺ to say, Ya ayyuha al-kafirun, na a'budu ma ta'budun, wa la antum a'abiduna ma a'bud, wa la ana a'abidu ma a'abatum. So you're not going to worship what I'm going to worship. I'm not going to worship what you're going to worship. The end of it is, lakum dinakum waliyadin. You worship your gods, let me worship mine. So it's actually a call to coexistence in a way, but the point is that let everyone do his thing. You go ahead, you worship your gods, let me worship mine in peace, but I will not compromise. Even in my most vulnerable moments, we have to stick to our principles and we have to stick to that belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Nasr is the end result of not compromising. The last surah revealed in entirety, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. So fast forward 20 years, this is what happens now. You see people entering into the religion in throngs. The same people that used to tell you to relinquish your worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are now coming in waves to worship your Rabb, to worship your Lord. Surah Al-Masad, Tabbat Yada Abi Lahab and Watab, mentions the humiliation of Abu Lahab and the punishment of Abu Lahab, who first said to the Prophet ﷺ, when the Prophet ﷺ made his call for people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who first stood up and humiliated the Prophet ﷺ. So now Abu Lahab is humiliated. And now finally, the last three quls, which are so important to us, which we should be reading day and night. Qul huwa Allahu Ahad, which is the surah that gives us the essence. It lays the basics, the basis of the creed of this religion, gives us the essence of the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qul huwa Allahu Ahad, Allahu Samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. It combines elements of rububiyyah and uluhiyyah and al-asma' al-sifat. It combines all the elements of his lordship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's glory, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's not being called, not having anyone else called upon beside him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's unique attributes and his essence. So Surah Al-Ikhlas is to sincerely dedicate ourselves to the worship of this one omnipotent creator, sustainer, God. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ, who does not begot, nor is he begotten, and he and no one is equivalent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then finally, the last two mu'awwidhat, to ask Allah to protect us. Surah Al-Falaq, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, is protection from, most of all, from people. Surah An-Nas is protection from the shaitan. So if you look at the two surahs, Surah Al-Falaq is protection from harm that comes from people. Surah An-Nas is protection from harm that comes from the shaitan and the whispers of the shaitan. In any case, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be people of Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all of our works and everything that we've done this month and beyond this month. Jazakumullah khairan. Seriously, I can't thank you guys enough for tuning in throughout this entire month. Thank you for being in my office. Literally, you've given an entire day of the month of Ramadan to these lessons. So I ask Allah to accept on your behalf and my behalf, especially those of you that were regular. Jazakumullah khairan. It was an absolute pleasure, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept everything from all of us. And I hope you guys enjoy your Eid, inshallah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.